Hey, buddies, Potato McWhiskey here, and welcome to the first look of João III. I have no idea how to pronounce his name. Listen, I've tried in Portugal. We're going to go ahead and just do a first impression and check him out.
João III leads Portugal in Sid Meier's Civilization VI. King of Portugal in the 1500s, João is known for using shrewd trading practices rather than open warfare as a means of conquest. Portugal's unique ability, Passa da Índia, significantly increases the yields of international trade routes.
Wow, look at those trade routes. Jesus, it looks like he gets a 50% boost to trade route gold, which is pretty insane. 33 gold trade route is pretty ridiculous. Considering trade routes are already super high value, you can get a ton of value from trade routes. Although that 50% effect might be from something else, I can't tell, but that looks super great.
But limits those routes to cities on the coast or with a harbor. This ability also grants trader units additional range on water and the ability to embark on water tiles as soon as they're unlocked.
That's really, really cool. Being able to embark without tech, that's pretty helpful. And there is a bit of a restriction. You have to trade with coastal cities. That's going to make this sieve very much so a naval sieve, right? You're not going to be able to do a huge amount of trading on a Pangaea map. But on the other hand, you still get like super powerful trade routes. So it seems like a pretty small downside to something that has a really big upside. International trade routes are already pretty damn strong. So having better international trade routes is just great. I would argue that international trade routes are actually better than internal trade routes the majority of the time. There are certain niche cases where you will want to trade internally rather than externally. But it seems like with João, oh my god, I forgot how to say his name already. But with Portugal, it looks like international trade routes are just the way to go no matter what.
Portugal's unique unit, the Nau, is a naval melee unit that replaces the Caravel. It starts with one free promotion, requires less maintenance than the Caravel, and has two charges to build Feitorias.
Wow, that's really cool. The Feitoria, looks like it gives it gold and production. It's really, really cool that it's a caravel replacement unit that can build a improvement. And it also looks like it was building it in another player's territory. That's really interesting. A really cool mechanic that I would hope to see a bit more of, actually.
These special shipping ports, unique to Portugal, grant additional gold and production from trade routes to that city. A Feitoria can only be built by a Nau naval unit on a foreign coastal tile next to a luxury or bonus resource. Portugal's unique build.
Wow, so it said it gave it extra yields of some kind? What were those extra yields?
Grant additional gold and production from trade routes to that city.
So it grants you extra production and gold from trade routes to that city. That's really, really powerful. That gives you a use. You know, you could get some early galleys, upgrade them into Naus. I assume you'll be able to upgrade them. Or get a couple of Naus when you're doing your international trade on the naval map with someone who you're friends with. Really, really cool opportunities to, make some interesting stuff out of this. And the person who's trading with Portugal actually gets a benefit. So this is super cool.
Our naval unit on a foreign coastal tile next to a luxury or bonus resource. Portugal's unique building, the Navigation School, replaces the university. It increases production towards naval units, increases science yields based on the number of coastal and lake tiles within the city's borders, and grants additional Great Admiral points.
Very, very cool. That seems like a relatively powerful building. You get the baseline abilities of a university, which are already pretty good, right? Universities give you a ton of science, they give you a little bit of housing, they give you some great scientist points. Getting an additional production boost towards naval units, super powerful on any sort of naval game where you're going for any sort of sea-based gameplay, gonna be super helpful, especially if you get those universities early, then you can tech into the Nau really quickly and then you produce them faster. So this all seems to work really well together. I'm wondering how they kind of tie all of this together, but the design of this just feels amazing. The plus one science for every two coastal lake tiles in a city, that's just super powerful because it will also mean that you will want some kind of border growth as Portugal, a way to sort of increase how many tiles you're claiming, because you're getting signs for every two of those coastal tiles you're claiming. So things like monuments are going to be super important. Things like basically anything that gives you culture is going to be important for this civ as well, because you want those borders to expand. And you could maybe even use your excessive amounts of gold to buy more tiles and just maximize those science yields. Very cool. I like that it scales into the late game and that it scales off of culture and gold. Very, very cool building. Excited to use it. One kind of question mark I have, secret societies is pretty common, so it's going to conflict with the Hermetic Order building, the Alchemical Society, which kind of sucks, but hey, look, it is what it is.
Juo's unique ability, Porta do Circo, grants all units increased sight.
It also— Whoa, plus one sight is actually massive. Not only if you're playing on a land game, your scouts are going to be able to see further, your settlers are going to be able to see further, your builders, everything is just going to be able to see further. And your naval units are going to be able to see a lot more tiles. I think actually, a lot of people think plus one sight range is like, plus one sight range. How big of a deal is that? But you're actually like uncovering a much bigger portion of the map, because sight range works in sort of both directions. It's a radius thing, so you get the benefit left and right of the unit. So if you're walking in a straight line, every tile that you walk, you're actually revealing two more tiles. So it's a huge amount. Like if a unit has a default sight range of two, that means every time they step forward, they reveal somewhere between three and five tiles. If they have a sight range of three, they're revealing five to seven tiles. So it's actually a massive boost to your scouting ability.
Also increases trade route capacity whenever Portugal meets a new civ, and provides open borders with all city-states.
Ooh, that sounds insane. Especially the open borders with city-states thing, because this is a civ that just always goes for the Elves of Minerva here. And the open borders with city-states thing is massive, because you'll be able to use the Nao to build those feitorias in their cities. And the fact that you get a trade route for every civ in the game means that this is actually a really strong culture civ. You have really good international trade routes. You get a ton of extra trade routes. Trade routes are a way for you to generate culture, because you can get extra tourism, or generate extra tourism, because you can generate extra tourism pressure based on having trade routes. And you get a trade route for every civ in the game. So you don't even need to build. You don't even need to build harbors as this civ. You can just make do with all the free trade routes you're getting and get a ridiculous yield. Exploration is going to be super important for Portugal in any game, because you need to get those first meets in order to get those benefits. Super amazing civ, super strong, really, really powerful. I am actually hyper excited to try this civ out.
Start the game by exploring a lot and try to meet every civ as quickly as possible for free trade route capacity. Since Portugal can only trade internationally with cities on coast or with harbors, be sure to prioritize naval exploration. Further supercharge your trading with lots of alliances and policy cards like Triangular Trade and Wisselbanken. Once you build a navigation school, start cranking out Nao units for Feitorias. But plan carefully, because Feitorias have strict placement restrictions.
Oh my god, look at that trade route! This trade route starts off at 76.5 gold per turn. Holy Jesus Christ! That is a ridiculous amount. It starts off at 76 production, or 76 gold, 3 production, and then after they build those feitorias, it goes up to, 88 production, or 88 gold and 6 production. That's insane, dude. That is ridiculous. That is so much. Wow. I don't even know what to say. This trade route, this trade route, dude. That's so much production, that's so much food. You stack Wisselbanken and you stack those triangular trade cards, you stack that international, what's the name of that card that gives you culture and science from international trade routes, whatever. This is the trading civ. Oh my god, this is it. This is the trading civ. I am so excited to play these guys. This is insane what you could do with this civ in terms of trade routes. Like this trade route alone is making the production gold and science and culture of like a small city. That's ridiculous. And you get a bunch of free trade routes. This is the civ. I cannot wait to do a trading game as this civ. I am super excited.
Will you journey beyond your shores to share riches from distant lands? How will you lead Portugal in Sid Meier's Civilization VI?
Wow, this is a sieve. This is a really, really well-designed sieve. It's completely centered around trading, sending trade routes in particular because of all their abilities. Like, they get extra yields on their trade routes, and they get more trade routes, and they get abilities to buff those trade routes with their unique unit, and then they can build their unique unit faster if they build their unique building. It's like, this sieve is 100% tailored towards getting the maximum amount out of trading. You're going to have, I'm like, genuinely, you're going to have in like some sort of naval game, you're going to have gold per turns upwards of like 1,000 to 2,000 gold in the mid game. That's in the mid game. You're going to have, it's insane what this sieve can do in terms of trade routes. I'm super excited for it. I cannot wait to play it. I almost just want to play a completely vanilla game with this sieve and just see how many trade routes I can get. Although actually I would probably add in like secret societies to get more trade routes too. But yeah, super excited. This is a cool sieve. I love you all very much. And I'll see you guys next time. Bye bye.